I've been diving in Scapa Flow now for on and off probably 20 years. And I remember the very first time I came to Scapa, somebody told me that I should go as quick as I could because very soon everything will be gone, that the wrecks were degrading and everything was changing, so I needed to go now. And I kind of thought this year, well, those wrecks are still here. 100 years after they sank and 20 years after I first started diving on these wrecks, they're still incredible dives. So I thought, well, maybe they are changing, but they're certainly not disappearing. So what I wanted to do was to bring some people back to Scapa Flow that had already been here and dived and were familiar with the wrecks. And I wanted them to take a look at the wrecks in a way that could begin a process of trying to see if these wrecks are changing. Now, for sure, they do change in some way, but it's difficult unless you make repeated observations on these wrecks to know what's changing and how they're changing. And I started thinking about why that might be. Why would somebody say the wrecks have changed? And so I looked at my own diving, and my own diving basically started back in the early 90s. And my parents were scuba divers as well. And when I did my very first dives on the south coast of England, it was a dive site that my father particularly was very familiar with. And when he asked me what I'd seen on my first few dives under this pier, he told me of lobsters and crab and fish and artifacts that were under this pier. You know, hundreds of things he listed to me that I should have seen on this dive. And I saw one or two of those things. And I thought, well, maybe this place has changed. Maybe those things that he saw are no longer there. So I was a little bit disappointed, and so was he. And then my diving carried on, and I remember one place that I must have dived 100, 200 times. And somebody once asked me what I would see if they went to this dive site. It's called the Orkney Islands in the northeast of England. And I listed off 100 things that you would see at this dive site on the Orkney Islands: seals and lobster and conger eels and wrecks and all the things that I knew after 200 dives you had the chance of seeing. But the thing is, you don't see all of those things on one dive. My memory has compressed all of the interesting things from all those dives I've done into one story. And I guess that's what my dad had done. He'd compressed his memory of everything he'd ever seen under Swanage Pier into one simple story. The way that we remember things changes. The way that we remember things isn't a very accurate measure of the particular state of a dive site. So I thought this was probably something to do with why people think the wrecks are changing. And there's another thing about the wrecks in Scapa Flow is they are so big. The cruisers are, you know, 160 meters long. The battleships are nearly 200 meters long. So there is so much to see. The second time you visit, the third time you visit, you will see different things and you will notice different things and you will become better at finding the interesting things on the wrecks. So again, if you find, for example, on your first trip to Scapa Flow, you find one gun and on your second trip you find seven, then maybe you think there's more guns or maybe you think the wrecks are opening up, but you might just be better at finding guns. So I thought, again, this could be a perceptual difference. So I thought the only way we can really truly tell if these wrecks are changing is to measure certain things on those wrecks. And that's what I tried to do this week. I wasn't really sure what we exactly were going to measure. So the first dives we did, we just looked around for things that we thought might change. So an evidence of, for example, a deck peeling away from the superstructure. There were areas that you can see, well, that wasn't like that when the ship sank. The deck was definitely attached to the hull when she sank, and now it isn't. So this is clearly a change over 100 years. But then you can say, well, if it's moved 5 meters in 100 years, maybe by next year it's moved 5.5 meters. Maybe you can plot how this deck peels away from the ship over a course of time. And then you can say, yes, this ship is degrading to this degree.
Citizen scientists are the best tool we have to collect data underwater and to support research projects, since it is really hard to get enough well-trained divers required to support projects at this level. With just public funding, it's close to impossible to conduct these kind of projects. That's why we as professional scientists are extremely happy to have citizen scientists to back us up in order to do the job efficiently, safely, and with appropriate scientific precision. Divers on projects of this level need to have a basic understanding of the scientific method and sound skills as scientific divers. Otherwise, the measurements lack in scientific correctness and cannot be used for peer-reviewed publications. From a scientific perspective, all the effort would be worthless then.
I think we've achieved more than I thought we would this week. I think the most interesting thing for me is that we've generated a team of 12 divers that are motivated to continue doing this work. And that to me is the key. Unless you have the people that are interested in doing this work, then you don't get the results. We've also learned how to evaluate to some extent the marine life that exists on these ships as well. So we've learned a lot of, or we've scratched the surface of a lot of measurement techniques, so that when we come back next year, we can jump straight in and start surveying and measuring and counting the marine life.
I'm very excited about the release of the GUE Scientific Diver class, and I'm really looking forward to see the first GUE trained scientific divers on the Scapa project very, very soon.